Welcome. So far we have seen 5 metaheuristic algorithms: teaching learning based optimization, particle swarm optimization, differential evolution, genetic algorithm, and artificial bee colony optimization. So before moving to constraint optimization, we thought we'll compare all the survival strategies and the variation operators which we have discussed in this 5 technique. So we thought to put it in a consolidated form so that it's easier for you to refer back, and also if you are planning to design new algorithms, you can make use of this revision. So first we'll be looking into the variation operators. So variation operators are used to generate new solutions from the existing solutions. So in TLBO, new solutions were generated either using the teacher phase or in the learner phase, right? So in the teacher phase, we'll get one solution, and in the learner phase, we'll get one solution. In teacher phase, we'll use the solution Xi to generate the new solution X new, right? So Xi is the current solution for which we are generating a new solution. R is random number between 0 and 1, right? So this has to be 1 cross D, where D is the number of decision variable, X best is the best solution in the population, X mean is the mean of the population, and teaching factor is either 1 or 2. Remember, it is not between 1 and 2, it is either 1 or 2. And teaching factor is a constant, is a scalar value, 1 cross 1, irrespective of the dimension of the problem. So that's how we will be generating a new solution in the teacher phase. Whereas in the learner phase, we will be generating a new solution by selecting a partner from the population. So if we are generating a solution for Xi, the solution Xi, we need to select a partner from the population, right? So one of these equations we need to use. So if the fitness of the ith member is less than fitness of the partner, then we will have to use the first equation, else we will have to use the second equation. Again, here R is a random number, it has to be between 0 and 1, and this is also 1 cross D. This is how we will be generating new solutions in teaching learning based optimization. In particle swarm optimization, we had to update the velocity of the particle first, then we had to determine the position. So for determining the velocity in t plus 1th generation, we will have to use the velocity of the tth generation. W, C1 and C2 are user defined parameters. R1 denotes random numbers between 0 and 1, and it has to be of the dimension 1 cross D. So for every decision variable, we will have to generate one random number. Same thing with R2, this is also 1 cross D. Xi is the particle position for which we are updating the velocity. P best is the best solution which was obtained for the ith particle so far, right? So that is P best, and G best is the global best of the entire population. So remember, this is not G best of I, but only G best, right? So once we find out the particle velocity, we can update the position. So X of I of T plus 1th iteration is of Tth iteration, and T plus 1 velocity obtained in the T plus 1th generation. So here, this is how the variation operator is used to generate a new solution. In differential evolution, for every particle I, we had to find out the donor vector. While determining the donor vector, we had to select 3 random solutions, right? So this random solution should not be the same member for which we are determining the donor vector. F is a scalar value, right? Irrespective of the number of decision variables, it is just a scalar value known as scaling factor, and it is a constant which is between 0 and 2. So once we determine this donor vector, then we will have to get the trial vector, right? So trial vector, the values of the trial vector will either come from the donor vector or the target vector using these conditions, right? So here PC denotes the crossover probability, and this delta is a randomly generated integer variable between 1 and D, right? This ensures that at least one member is copied from the donor vector to the trial vector. In differential evolution, this is how we employ variation operators to generate new solutions. Here we have discussed only binomial crossover. You can look into the previous videos to see the exponential crossover also. In genetic algorithm, we had to generate this parameter beta. So this beta has to be generated for every decision variable, right? So as many decision variables are there, that many random numbers we need to generate between 0 and 1. If the random number is less than or equal to 0.5, we update the beta using this equation. Here eta c is a user defined parameter, right? So once we calculate beta, either using this part or using this part, we can calculate the two offsprings, right? So over here, pa dash and pb dash denote the parents. So in for generating even one offspring, we need two solutions, which are the parent solution which we had found from the mating pool, right? For this crossover to happen, we need to select another random number, right, which has to be less than the crossover probability. So if we have a problem with d decision variables, then we'll have to generate d plus 1 random numbers between 0 and 1. The first random number will decide whether we will do crossover or not. If we decide to do crossover, if this condition is satisfied, then we'll have to generate the additional d random numbers to find out the beta values. Once the beta value is found out, we can generate the two offspring using these two equations, right? Similarly, for mutation, we need to generate first one random number between 0 and 1. If that happens to be less than mutation probability, then we need to undergo mutation, right? Else mutation is not to be performed. If this condition is satisfied, then we need to generate additional d random numbers between 0 and 1, right? So if those random numbers are less than 0.5, we need to use this equation to determine the delta. Else we need to use this equation to determine the delta. Eta m again is a user defined parameter. Similar to SBX crossover, in polynomial mutation also, we need to generate d different random numbers so that we get d different deltas, right? Once this delta is obtained, we can calculate the new offspring using this equation. In artificial bee colony optimization, the equation which is used to generate a new solution is this, right? So the same equation is used in employed bee phase as well as in onlooker bee phase, right? So this equation is same. Unlike the four other techniques, right, wherein all the variables were changed. So for example, if we look into this, so if I have a three variable problem, 289, let's say XR1 is 289, let's say scaling factor is 0.8, and the other two solutions are, let's say, 653 minus 279, right? So all the variables would get changed. All the variables are modified to get this VI. Since VI is changing, most likely the trial vectors will also be having many values from VI, right? So it's not like we'll be changing only one value, whereas in artificial bee colony optimization, right, we will be deciding on which variable to change. We'll be changing only one variable, right? So here, if we have solution, let's say 234, and the partner solution is 497, then first we'll have to decide which is the variable that we are going to change. So that J variable is to be randomly selected. So between 1 and 3, we'll have to randomly select one variable, right? So let us assume that we are selecting the third variable, right? So this 2, 3 will remain constant. Only this 4 will get changed according to this equation, right? So here again, XP is a randomly selected partner, J is the randomly selected decision variable, and phi is a random number between minus 1 and 1. So that is unique about artificial bee colony optimization when compared to the other four algorithms, that only one variable is changed over here. And then in onlooker bee phase, the variation operator is same. Only thing is that we'll have to check this probability. So if this condition is satisfied, in that case, that particular onlooker bee explores the ith food source, right? The equation that we use to generate new solution is similar to what we used in employed bee phase, right? So whereas in scout bee phase, we randomly generate a solution, right, between the lower bound and upper bound. Remember, again in scout bee phase, we were generating only one new solution, right? So for every solution, we had to keep track of the trial vector. This trial vector denotes as to how many times the solution got an attempt to generate a new solution but failed to generate a better solution than itself, right? So if there are 5 solutions which exceed this limit, like, again, limit is a user defined parameter. If 5 solutions exceed this parameter limit, so let's say if the trial for 5 solutions are 8, 9, 7, 3, 2, 12, and the limit is, let's say, is 6, right? So in that case, since this solution has the maximum number of failures, we'll be updating the solution corresponding to the 12 failures, right? So only one new solution is generated. So this slide shows all the variation operators put in one place for the 5 algorithms which we have discussed. Given this, you can now think of developing your own variation operator, which can be used to develop a new algorithm. So now that we have discussed the variation operator, let's quickly see how the survival strategies differ from one algorithm to the other algorithm, right? So consider this case wherein, let's say, this is a set of solutions that we have. And these are the set of solutions which get generated at some point of time in the algorithm. Right? So these are old solutions, these are new solutions. So this is the decision variable. Let's say this is a two variable problem. So we have x1 and x2, and this is the fitness function value corresponding to 3 and 1. Assume that there is some objective function for in which if we substitute x1 is equal to 3 and x2 is equal to 1, we get a fitness function value of 10. Right? So here we have these 5 solutions and their corresponding fitness function. Similarly, in new solutions, let us say these 5 solutions get generated 4, 3, 1, 2, 4, 2, 1, 0 and 3, 1, and this is their corresponding fitness function value 25, 5, 20, 1 and 10. Broadly, we employed 3 different type of survival strategies. The first one is the greedy strategy. So in greedy strategy, what we did is like we compared fitness of this first solution with the fitness of the first new solution. So between 10 and 25, 10 is better, right? So we took that. So between 26 and 5, 5 is better. So we took this 1, 2. Right? Between 18 and 20, this 18 is better, right? So we took that 18 and the corresponding solution is 3, 3. So that is taken. Between 4 and 1, the solution 1 is better and their corresponding solution is 1, 0. So that is what we retain, right? And between 4, 1 and 3, 1, the fitness is 17, and 10. So 10 is better, right? So we take 10 over here, right? And the corresponding solution. So this greedy strategy we employed in TLBO. Remember in TLBO what we did was the first solution underwent teacher phase and we generated a new solution. If the new solution is better, we took that solution into the population. Same thing we did in the learner phase also, right? So in those cases, we were using greedy strategy, right? So in TLBO we use greedy strategy. Similarly in ABC also we did the same thing, that the first B undergoes the employed B phase. If it generates a better solution, that better solution is taken into the population, right? So employed B phase as well as the onlooker B phase, we employed this greedy strategy, right? In scout B phase we did not employ this strategy, right? We generated a new solution and whether it was good or bad, it was taken into the population, right? Similarly, in DE, we use this greedy strategy, right? So we had, let's say we have 20 solutions, we generate 20 more solutions in DE, compare the first old solution with the first new solution, and whichever is better was taken into the new population, right? So this greedy strategy is the one that we widely used in 3 algorithms, right? The other strategy is mu, lambda strategy. In this mu, lambda strategy, the new solution is always taken into the population, right? We do not care whether it is better or not, right? It is always taken into the population. So this, if you remember, we did it in particle swarm optimization as well as the scout phase of ABC. So what we basically did was, let's say if these were the old solution 10, 26, 18, 4 and 17, and these are the new solutions 25, 5, 20, 1 and 10, right? We did not take the old solutions, or we did not do a comparison between 10 and 25, 26 and 5, 18, 20, 4, 1, 17, 10. We did not do that comparison. We directly took the new set of solutions, right? So here if you see, this is identical to the new solutions, right? So this is known as mu, lambda strategy. So this we had used in particle swarm optimization as well as scout phase of ABC. And then we had this mu plus lambda strategy wherein we combined all the solutions. And we use this only in GA, right? So here what we did was, we have this 10, 26, 18, 4, 17 and this new solutions 25, 5, 20, 1 and 10. So we had 5 old solutions, we generated 5 new solutions. So out of these 10 solutions, we had to select 5 best solutions. So what we did is, we selected the 5 best solutions. So 1, 4, 5, 10, 10. So this is what we did in mu plus lambda strategy. So these are the 3 strategies which we have seen in different algorithms. So here as you can see, for example, in ABC one phase we employed greedy strategy, and in another phase, in the scout B phase, we employed a mu, lambda strategy. So similarly, when you are designing an algorithm, you can choose to incorporate any one of these strategies or a combination of these strategies, or you can even come up with your own strategies. So that concludes this session. In this session, we basically revised the survival strategies and the variation operators which we came across in these 5 algorithms. Thank you.